this technology is replacing workers. We expect maybe by the end of 50 years for technology to have replaced the sex workers. It's possible. This house will severely limit companies' ability to replace workers with technology. A lot of the redefined digital at this moment. To limit is to restrict. A technology, this is man-made machines and artificial intelligence, bring us the redefined motion for this debate. This house would severely restrict companies' ability to replace workers with man-made machines and artificial intelligence. We have managed to come up with a line of argument that is going to be our pillar of strength throughout the whole course of this debate. Now, our line of argument, we are saying replacing workers with technology has a very detrimental effect, not only to the retrained workers themselves, but also to the businesses and the market. So we are saying companies should not be allowed to replace their workers with technology. Now, bringing you to our status quo, what's apparently happening and the problem with this debate, this policy motion? Apparently, jobs have been lost, and this has been a result of the advancements in technology being initiated. Now, in order to solve this problem, we have managed to adopt a policy that is going to be introduced by my seventh speaker, introducing you to our case studies, whereby my seventh speaker is going to look at the advantages of our policy and also shed more light on what our policy is in this debate. And as the first speaker, I'm only here to feed to you the detrimental effects posed by the retrenchment of workers, not only to the retrenched workers themselves, but also to business and the market at large. Now, I shall go straight to give you what I have to say, representing the affirmative delegation. Now, I want to say retrenchment of workers is going to promote very low standards of living. Now, we do understand that people, in order to survive, they need a source of income. As if they are replaced by machines and they lose their source of income, how are they going to get a living? They need income. And at the end of the day, if we keep on retrenching workers, we're going to promote lower standards of living for most of the people we actually have. Now, if you think technology is not really replacing a lot of people, allow me to show you how technology is actually, in actual fact, replacing a lot of people. Only in the UK, it is estimated that after 15 years, about 15 million people are going to be retrenched and replaced by technology. And this is provided by our evidence, Exhibit G1. Now, why not wonder, if we are really not considerate people, are we going to give these machines to replace the people? About 15 million people being replaced in only 15 years. That is quite inconsistent. Now, moving on to the other detrimental effect posed to the workers themselves, I would like to talk about promotion of great economic disparity. Now, economic disparity is a gap that exists between the poor people and the rich people. Now, with retrenchment, now, in a company, there's going to be more productivity, which means greater profits are going to be shared amongst fewer people, since the majority of people have been retrenched. Which means that one side, they're going to have a very rich people, whilst on the other hand, we have very poor people, because they will have lost their source of income, which is promotion of great economic disparity. There's going to be a larger gap between the poor people and the rich people. And all this is coming as a result of replacing workers with technology. Now, going on to the detrimental effects posed not to the retrenched workers, but the business. I want to introduce to you a policy, or rather, what we call the buying power. Now, the buying power comes from the income or salary the person gets. So if workers are retrenched, then demand for goods are going to become very low, because workers will have lost their buying power because they're not getting income. So this is also going to be detrimental to the business itself and the market as well. If you think technology is not even replacing a lot of people, imagine this. We now have technology to replace security guards as provided by Exhibit G2, I think.
Always mutating, new discoveries being made, technological advances. network that has its roots in ongoing advancements in technology. Each time a revolution in the methods of production occurs, it is inevitable that some people will experience the bitter end of the stick. Take, for example, the industrial and the agrarian revolution that occurred in Britain. Ironically, a recession in the need for human labor also occurred. Just think, had these developments been due to the unemployment that was there during that time, would we be talking about industry today? No, a transition is a necessary evil. Why concentrate on a seemingly big problem and yet inhibit a great revolution whose only motive is to make life a bit more bearable? Ladies and gentlemen, we're not advocating that companies should not have some sort of regulation. Yes, they can be big, but the moment these become stringent and fear, there comes the problem. It would, without a shade of doubt, limit technology's ability to make life easier and that's the core purpose. In conclusion, humankind has an inherent weakness of believing one thing and not what is. Clearly, limiting a company's ability to replace with such technology is not the way to go. That is, I thank you.
She's a right, but she can be penalized for that. She's encouraged. Accept at least one.
At least one.
It's safe. They can ask three times. But not more than three times.
In this debate, we have been accused of being retrogressive. But what we are doing is we are not banning technology. What we are saying is that we would severely limit companies' ability to replace workers with technology. Because, get this issue, if we want companies to replace workers with technology, these workers are going to be replaced, and at the end of the day, they're going to be unemployed. And if they're unemployed, they do not have any source of income. And at the end of the day, they cannot buy those goods that are being produced by these companies that are actually employing the use of technology. Therefore, what we're saying, ladies and gentlemen, is that technology, replacing workers with technology, reduces the buying power of employees. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm the second speaker, standing firmly, unshakingly and steadfast before the motion that says that this House, it severely limits companies' ability to replace workers with technology. Now, as I've stated by my first speaker, we have redefined limit as restrict technology as artificial intelligence and or man-made machines. Now, ladies and gentlemen, to bring back the issue, it says that a company is not a charity organization. And we are agreeing with this, ladies and gentlemen. A company is not a charity organization. It is solely bent on making profit. But what we're saying is that if all workers are replaced by technology, technology is going to take the place of workers, and the workers are going to be unemployed. At the end of the day, workers cannot buy whatever has been produced by these companies. Now, ladies and gentlemen, tonight, as an affirmative side, we have come up with a policy. And our policy is this. We would severely limit companies' ability to replace workers with technology by allowing only 10% of workers to be retrained. 10% of workers only to be retrained. And we would use bodies such as the International Labour Organization to replace these people, ladies and gentlemen. And these people are only to be removed from the company, only if they have alternative sources of employment. What we are against, ladies and gentlemen, is to leave people unemployed because of technology. Because, as we have stated, it is counterproductive. We want, ladies and gentlemen, to keep the buying power of people and to keep the firm. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we would also...
technology is so much to unemployment. How then do you come from the country that you're saying to the high technology of it and a low unemployment?
Ladies and gentlemen, the United States of America has a low unemployment rate. But that unemployment rate that is there in the United States is solely caused mostly by technology. Therefore, that point goes no water. And our policy, ladies and gentlemen, to continue, we would find those companies that do not agree to our policy. And with the fines that we inflict on these people, we would use the money to support the companies that are actually following our policies so that we would support their wages because these people would still employ workers. We would only allow the companies to retrench 10% only if they are alternative sources of employment, ladies and gentlemen. Because at the end of the day, it is counterproductive to chase people away from work and to produce and expect those goods to be bought by people who are not employed and therefore who do not have any source of income. To continue with our policy, ladies and gentlemen, in this debate, we are not saying that we should ban technology. We are only saying that we should severely restrict companies' ability to replace workers with technology. We are not saying that we should ban technology, and I repeat, therefore, we are not going to visit. Our policy is more sound, it is more sustainable, it is more acceptable, it is more practical, and it is necessary because as it stands, people unemployment A. A1 and robots threatened to unleash mass unemployment by the year 2020. 5 million jobs are predicted to be lost. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what we're saying is that the pace of technologicalization is increasing. Therefore, there is need to guard against unemployment, because at the end of the day, it is counterproductive, as we have said. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if only the more skilled with machines are only going to be equipped, this means that very few people are going to be equipped. That is going to be expected, because only those people who are equipped will be equipped. I think, ladies and gentlemen, I thought it was like this.
Thank you. This house would severely restrict companies' ability to replace workers with man-made machinery and artificial intelligence. That is how our definition of motion works. Now, I like how before this debate has been, technological change, uncontrolled technological change, must be controlled, and otherwise, we are kept. Now, what I'm saying is this. You have technical change, they've been comparing, as they said, 140 years ago, that's 1860 coming forward, 140 years ago, then you take those numbers and add them up, it will look favorable on the side of technology. What I'm saying is, in recent years, in the 2000s, technological change has increased at pace. Now, what this means is, give an example of the agricultural pollution. What this means is, there's agricultural pollution happening in the agricultural sector, in the primary sector, there's a pollution happening in the secondary sector, there's a very pollution happening in the services sector. What this means is that someone gets unemployed in the primary sector, they cannot move to any other sector of the economy because they are being replaced by machinery. As I said, that was submitted by our first speaker. Security workers are being replaced by robots. Just like the security worker you got is a robot. Where do you find work for people? That's what we simply say. Now, the opposition's whole debate depends upon the assertion that if technology has been creating jobs for the past, I don't know, 200 years, it will continue to do so in the future. Now, for the same point, for example, technological change is increasing. You have so many things that were here 100 years ago that were not created. In Zimbabwe, this is an example of Zimbabwe. Say that in Zimbabwe, we can't get a good education, unemployment rate, but we have no technology. What's a tractor? What's that car you're driving? What's all this stuff we see in the industries and all those machinery? We're saying 100 years ago, people working on the farms, people working in the cotton industry, they're working in the private sector. Today, no one is working, they're moving up. Now we're saying technology is coming and taking jobs from people. The machinery, the industries, anything and everything, mining our stuff, the things we make money out of, they've been taken over by technology, so it's a control. Our first speaker said companies are not charity organizations. We agree, but governments are. Governments are there to be responsible for their people. Now governments are responsible for controlling this rate of technological change because, as stated by the second speaker of the man appointed, technology is there to help people. Now, if technology is putting people out of their jobs, making unemployment, causing problems in society, which is limited change, limited space, we're not saying it's a delegation that will stop all technological change. What we're saying is we're going to control it. We're going to build step by step so that people aren't called out of their jobs or don't suffer. Our first speaker said the industrial agricultural revolution has happened and has enforced to be the people on jobs also, and as I've stated before, they happen at different times. Agricultural boom was a different time. Industrial boom was a different time. What we're facing today in the present day is an agricultural revolution, industrial revolution, and a service sector revolution at the same time. Where will one get unemployed in the service sector? Oh, no, you're unemployed, you have no money to feed your family, and so on and so on. Now, the exhibits, the opposition brought, they have no sources. We have 12 of people, exhibit B and exhibit C. They have no sources. They keep bringing us a document they could have titled their own, saying that 1 or 2 years ago, technology benefited. How do you know what you said is true? Now, the exhibit B also says, in the future, I quote from that exhibit, in the future, taxi drivers will complain about self-driven cars. In the future, taxi drivers will complain about self-driven cars. Now, what does this mean? This means the people who are driving taxis from the exhibit will be complaining about taxis. From technology, taxes that don't need people, they're out of their job. So these people are contradicting themselves by an exhibit, which you don't know if it's true or not, but they're simply contradicting themselves. Now, this whole debate rests upon the assertion that today, technology change is increasing. What I'm saying is people are getting taken off their jobs more quickly than before. What I'm saying is that jobs are becoming fewer. What do we do? We limit, as our country policy stated, 10% only that we find those who infringe. That's why we're saying it's a delegation. Thank you.
A present day to all. We still stand strongly against the motion which reads, The people present here would intend to limit the business capacity to replace workers with technology with practical application of mechanical arts and applied science. Our main argument throughout this debate is hinged upon the fact that technology is man's invention to make life easier for them. If this technology seems to be replacing workers, is it not serving its sole purpose, that is to make life easier for the workers? Certainly it is. Therefore, why must we severely restrict this technology? Therefore, the point they raised holds no water. They also brought up in their redefinition, they stated that machines are man-made. As I already stated, why are these machines made? To make life easier for the workers, ladies and gentlemen. Therefore, they must replace the workers if there is need to. That's the point they raised holds no validity. They also brought up, their counter policy stated that instead of replacing all workers with technology, let's replace 10% of the workers. Ladies and gentlemen, companies have got rights. There is no one in the rights of the company where it is stipulated that they are supposed to be, they are not supposed to replace workers with technology. Matter of fact, as a matter of fact, they are allowed to do whatever they want. If they decide to replace a worker with technology, it is up to them, for they have the choice to employ and to employ as well as to fire an individual from a company. Therefore, the point they raise holds no water. Furthermore, to counter their so-called counter policy, ladies and gentlemen, instead of trying to change the already present system, let us instead work on the individuals, ladies and gentlemen. That is to create individuals who are able to adapt to the already changing systems. This can be done in the education sector. Therefore, their counter policy is not even a counter policy at all. Moving on, they also brought up the point that technology is linked to unemployment. Ladies and gentlemen, we ought to look beyond the horizon. The affirmative delegation seems to be looking at the workers who have been directly replaced by technology, but not looking beyond this matter, ladies and gentlemen. Instead, technology has actually created employment for other people. Like our second speaker already stated, the people who have created those machines, the people responsible for the software, ladies and gentlemen, and the people responsible for transporting that machinery to that particular institution. Therefore, the point they raised holds no water. Moving on, the third speaker stated that we are not banning technology, we are just severely limiting it. Ladies and gentlemen, a severe restriction is close to a ban. As our second speaker already stated, if you say that you are not banning an individual salary, but instead you're giving them a dollar after working for an entire month, is this not the absurdity, ladies and gentlemen? Certainly, it is. Therefore, their point holds no water. They also brought up the point that retrenchment leads to low working standards and workers will be reduced by their buying power. As we have stated, where there is change, there are a few short-term negative impacts. The affirmative delegation seems to be only looking at the status of the situation. Instead, after these workers have been replaced, but in the near future, this will in turn lead to the development of the products that are going to be produced in those particular firms. These projects will compete on the global market, and when these projects compete on the global market, this in turn will lead to national development, and is this not what we want for our nation? Certainly it is. Hence, not the point they raised holds no water. Ladies and gentlemen, a wise man does not make decisions based on mere judgment spread by the based on mere gossip spread by the main industry, but instead on facts. As a primitive delegation, we are showing you the facts that are associated with technology replacing workers, and this proves more long-term impacts compared to short-term impacts that the primitive delegation can't have on their own. Therefore, technology can replace workers.
And these jobs are more than those that have been destroyed by technology. And that's the entire argument. Hold on, wait. Salutations once more. As the non-affirmative, we still stand firmly against the motion of earlier on redefining us. The people here present would intensely restrict companies' abilities to replace workers with the practical application of mechanical arts and applied sciences. Ladies and gentlemen, throughout the debate, most of their points revolved around job loss. However, ladies and gentlemen, we've already presented which clearly shows that technology has actually created more jobs than those in the state. And that, ladies and gentlemen, all their points regarding jobs are thus now and void. They also try to disregard our existence, saying that it has no source, ladies and gentlemen. But ladies and gentlemen, we cannot force all our information onto one page. Flip to the very last page of that exhibit, and you'll find that it's exposed. That's our exhibit. It's still very much validated. Moreover, they also tried to disregard the exhibit, saying that it was information from 140 years. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it was information from 140 years up until now, meaning that exhibit is still very much valid. Moreover, ladies and gentlemen, they also say that from 140 years, but ladies and gentlemen, in statistics we know the greater the sample size, the more accurate the results. That's our exhibit is very much accurate in sight, making the argument now void. Moreover, ladies and gentlemen, during the cross-examination, they stated that unemployment is increasing due to technology, but presented no evidence to this effect. That's a completely disregarded point. We have been basing our entire argument on the fact that technology has simply served its purpose. That is, it has created more jobs for the people, has boosted the economy, has boosted their living standards. Well, ladies and gentlemen, when there are more, better, cheaper quality goods being produced due to efficient systems, we have a price slash in the essentials. That's, ladies and gentlemen, meaning more money for luxuries and then raising people's living standards. That's our argument. That's very much valid. Ladies and gentlemen, as my teammates and I have already stated, companies are not charity organizations. If people are looking for charity, then let them tend to philanthropic projects, clubs, and many other charity organizations. No one gets into business with the hope of making a loss, but with the hope of making a profit. Thus, ladies and gentlemen, allow them to do so. And how do they do so? They reduce productivity costs. They increase efficiency, ladies and gentlemen. And this is exactly what technology has been presenting to them. That's, ladies and gentlemen, why must we cling to an inefficient system when a new efficient system has already been created? Ladies and gentlemen, let us take the right path and side with the non-affirmative end of this conversation.
Company's ability to replace workers with man-made machines and artificial intelligence is the motion we're debating on, and we're supporting this motion. Now, as the Council delegation, we came up front and provided a clear line of argument and also a redefined motion, which I've already mentioned. Now, our line of argument in this debate was that technological unemployment causes a lot of harm, not only to the retrenched workers, but also to the business itself. And under this, when we're talking about the retrenched workers, we say that they're going to be lower standards of living promoted, and we also talked about how economic disparity is going to be promoted, which is the increase in the gap between poor people and the rich people. Now, this is how we managed to actually support our line of argument. As if this is not enough, since this is a policy motion, we came as governors and we introduced our own policy, which is that since the motion is not saying let us ban the replacement of workers and it's saying let us restrict, let us only allow companies to replace 10%, which is severe, 10% of their workers with technology. And also, we fine those companies that do not follow this particular policy and use that fine money to help those particular companies that have adopted this policy to support their work. And this is the policy we wanted to take as the Council delegation, since this was a policy debate. Now, allow me to move on to what the other delegation overlooked in this motion. Now, they came up front and provided their line of argument. Now, the other department, they say that technology makes life easier and it is serving its purpose. But I want to talk about the people who have been replaced, the security guards, for example, and also the taxi drivers, probably, and also some other people in bakeries and other industries. How is life made easier for these people? Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to support this by referring to our online content, how we say low standards of living are promoted and there is great economic disparity. If people are losing jobs, then they no longer have high power. Then how is life being made easier for them? So the other department was simply seeming as if it was reasonable at the surface, but if you actually dig deep into it, life is not being made easier by technology. So the other department now stands going to this debate, allow me to use their exhibit against their online department. Now, they gave us an exhibit that was suggesting that in the next few years, it was called Exhibit B, even taxi drivers are going to be replaced by auto-driving taxis. And yes, they claim with their line of argument that technology is actually making life easier for the people when the taxi drivers are even losing their jobs. It is not. Now, another mistake they they made was not even coming with the policy in a policy motion. This house would, which means it's a policy motion. So we identified the problem, which is that people are losing jobs and people are being retrenched, but they came up with no solution. But we managed to give it a reasonable policy, and they did not even manage to come up with a policy in a policy debate. But ladies and gentlemen, I shall leave the podium by saying this was just a summary of what we're saying as a delegation. I would like to give you a line of argument and a bunch of policy and evidence with sources unlike the land of country.
This was a nice debate. This was interesting. This was great. Hey. Mm-hmm. Kashasha.